Now what we will do today, what I will do for you today is introduce some of the principles, I mean not some, these are the four classic principles of medical ethics. How many of you are familiar with them? Anybody is? The doctors I know should be. The others? No, doesn't matter. They're not very esoteric principles, they're pretty straightforward. And I'll explain briefly what they are about. Then Professor Jiang will take you through examples, formulate these in a certain logical framework so you see the structure of their reasoning, what these principles involve in terms of reasoning, and what their strengths and weaknesses are in terms of how to, you know, evaluate them in terms of actual concrete examples. Okay, that would be our agenda for today. And then, of course, we would invite discussion, and maybe you will be provoked into discussion through what Professor Jiang will be doing with you all in terms of the examples. So now you have these four very classic principles that have been formulated. These were formulated, you know, after the Second World War, during the Nuremberg, I mean after the Nuremberg trials, and because of all the atrocities that were perpetrated. And so you had the Nuremberg Code, and what developed out of that was that medicine as an institution cannot act ethically unless it adopts these four principles. What I want to point out to you is that these principles are not exclusive to doctors, yes? So that you cannot say, when I'm sitting in my dispensary, when I'm acting as a doctor, this is fine, I'll adhere to them. After that, you know, these principles don't hold. They hold for all human beings, as you can see. What the principle of beneficence says, very simply, I mean, the Latin word is benefacere, that is to do good. Okay, it's as simple as that. And what it exhorts a doctor to do is that it is his duty to benefit his patients. So in acting as doctor, he must aim at a result through his action that would benefit his patient. That is the principle of benefits. That is his duty as doctor. Now, you can see that that is not only a doctor's duty. All of us, we should act to benefit others. That could be extended beyond that, beyond the doctors. But the doctor must definitely, as a professional, adopt this principle. Non-maleficence, malefacere is to do evil. So non-maleficence is, there are times when a doctor, it's not possible for a doctor to intervene to benefit his patient, in which case at least he shouldn't harm his patient. Okay? So in those cases, it's a fallback situation where the actions of a doctor are limited by circumstances, not to benefiting a patient. The least he should be doing is not undertake anything that would harm his patient. That again is a fairly intuitive kind of principle. Autonomy is maybe requires one or two words. Autonomy refers to the autonomous means self-governing, okay, self-ruled. The doctor should respect, and by respect, I don't mean just, you know, pay respects to, but adhere to or abide by and finally concede to the decision of the patient. The doctor cannot override a patient's decisions, should not. I mean, if he is to be ethical. Now, there are lots of problems that you will have with or clarification that you will need with respect to these principles, and particularly maybe with this, which we will be happy to provide to whatever extent we are capable. So that's what the principle of autonomy means, that the patient finally decides what will or will not happen to him or her. The doctor can at most advise, but cannot override. The principle of autonomy is really very, very fundamental. And of course, justice. The doctor must act in a manner that is just at all times. Now, what does justice mean? Justice does not translate simply into equality, yes? Because you, in being equal, you can be very unjust. So generally, thinkers distinguish between equality and equity. So what equity means is being fair, being just, not necessarily being equal. Equal treatment Supposing you treat everybody equally, then you won't have emergency wards. An emergency ward is precisely that some people have to be given preferential treatment in order to be just, okay, because they have come with, I mean, they may have come later than others to the hospital, but they have come with a more life-threatening kind of situation, and therefore you would have to, justice would demand, you see, justice would demand that you engage with them first. So that's something that you have to get. Now, justice can be comparative, distributive, etc. Comparative is when you're comparing two individuals. Supposing you have a criminal and the Prime Minister of India, both coming in for treatment at the same time in the emergency room. Whom are you going to treat first? What would justice demand of you, okay? That you treat the Prime Minister first, and why? That you treat the criminal, maybe the criminal has come fractionally before the Prime Minister, stretcher was moved in before the Prime Minister, stretcher was moved in. So he has probably a greater claim to being treated before the Prime Minister, but he's a known criminal. So you're going to have to confront, you will be confronting these decisions in your practice, okay, as doctors. So that is the issue of comparative justice. There is also the issue of distributive justice. How do you distribute the resources? No hospital, no doctor has an indefinite bag of resources from which to cater to. So how do you distribute? How does a hospital distribute its resources of cardiac care or you know, heart-lung machines or whatever else? If somebody requires it for a longer duration and somebody else requires it immediately, what are you going to be doing? Distributing the resources, which are probably axiomatically going to be scarce. No society has a superabundance of resources. Every society, including the most developed ones, will have certain resource constraints. In which case, then, how you distribute those resources will be an issue of distributive justice. Okay? Now, you must recognize that these principles are not, insulated from each other, in the sense that you can work the principle of beneficence without it coming into conflict with the principle of, let's say, autonomy. That is the most clear case of where two principles can conflict. A doctor might, all of us might clearly see that it is to the benefit of a patient to undergo a certain treatment, a certain procedure. But you have to respect the autonomy of the patient, and the patient might decide against that. So here is beneficence, your duty to do good, which is coming into conflict with your duty to respect the autonomous decision of the patient. So beneficence can very easily come into conflict with autonomy. And beneficence and non-maleficence could be the same. Each principle could conflict with the other, okay? But it's not only that level of conflict. You can have conflicts, let's say, between two principles on the one hand and a third principle. So what I'm trying to get at is that these four principles, if they are to be put into practice, can generate conflict at various levels between themselves. One on one, or if you adopt two, then you're going to be violating a third, or you'll have to decide between, you know, these two and a third, and so on. This is what I wanted to bring to your notice as an introduction. Now I think Professor Jung has finished getting his examples together, which he was desperately trying to do for PowerPoint presentation.
So the first thing that I would now like to start with is something which is called principle of analogy. Now this is a very old principle, and the purpose or the statement of this principle is this, that if you decide, if you are to decide morally between option A and option B, and supposing you decide, okay, you have chose A over B, Now, there is a principle under which your choice is based. So either you have thought like a utilitarian, talking in terms of benefits, or you might have thought as an egoist, or you might have thought as a deontologist, and you have decided in that particular situation. Now, this principle states that if you have taken up a principle, okay, and based your choice upon this principle, then for all such similar situations, that principle should be operative. Yeah? Which basically means that if you uphold the principle of analogy, then what it basically does is, it helps you, you know, avoid this arbitrariness and makes ethics applicable overall. So that theory becomes overall applicable. In other words, what it basically does is, it helps avoid ethics being a question of personal taste and opinion. So it's not just you deciding for that particular situation in which you are involved, but basically you are now giving a principle which will be applicable in all such situations for any individual who is confronted with a similar situation. Right? So basically, we have said that there are three important tests of finding out whether a theory is good or bad. Not good or bad in the moral sense, but in its applicative sense, whether a theory can be applied or a theory can't be applied. And we have said that this is, first of all, the principle of clarity, that a theory should not have any term that is unclear. So all the terms that are used in the theory should be absolutely clear. That is principle of clarity. Then we have said that, yes, let us see, what is the second one? Coherence, yes, that you should not get two principles out of a theory such that they conflict with each other. So that means your theory is not good. Third, what is the third one? Reflective equilibrium, right? You should have a theory which should not conflict with any principle which comes out of, you know, your moral intuition. If it does, then it does not have ethical reflective equilibrium. Apart from that, you also have to keep this in mind, principle of analogy, which states that if you have based a theory and this theory decides, okay, that you choose A over B in a particular situation, then it should be applicable overall, such that in any such situation, any individual who confronts this situation will also make the same decision. And this decision, whether you make it or anybody else makes it, will be ethical or moral. So this basically is the principle of analogy. Now, keeping this in mind, I would like to take you back to a valid argument form, modus ponens. If you remember, we said if S then P, S therefore P, right? If the patient takes this medicine, then he'll be fine. He takes the medicine, therefore he'll be fine. Or if it rains, then the ground will be wet. It's rain, therefore the ground is wet. If we heat a body, then it will expand. This body is heated, therefore it will expand. So this is a valid form. If S then P, S therefore P. Now I can alternatively formulate this argument as all S then P. All S rather, instead of then, just substitute is. All S is P, S therefore P. So this is a valid form of the modus ponens. It's just an alternative derivation that we are doing. All S is P, S therefore P. Right? Now with this, keep this argument form in your mind because this is a valid argument form, and we will now enter into the four principles of medical ethics. So what does this principle say? It basically says doctors should do that which benefit their patients. Now please keep this in mind. When we actually get this principle, we get it as a rule. As a rule, you must abide by this principle. But how has this principle come into being in the first place? And I'm not speaking about historical, in time of history, you know, this principle came into existence. What basically we are trying to ask is, what is the theory behind it? What is the theory which comes to this conclusion that doctors should do that which benefit their patients? Okay. Now the argument behind it is something like this. The premise is all doctors must undertake actions which benefit their patients. Right? You are a doctor. Conclusion, therefore, you should undertake actions which benefit your patient. Now, this conclusion is your rule here. Right? Now, if you see this, then the problem with this principle begins here. Now, according to this particular principle, what it basically tries to tell you is this, that actions which lead to the benefit of the patient is good, or it will constitute a moral behavior. If you accept this, then you have to clarify what benefit means. And this is precisely what is not clear. And that is why we have so many problems in medical ethics. The basic problem is because we have not yet outlined what this benefit means. Basically, it would mean what? Economic benefit, physical benefit, social benefit, spiritual benefit, emotional benefit, what sort of benefit? So this is itself not decided explicitly. See, if you just don't consider this, don't even consider this, then we think that we understand what the principle means. So we think that we intuit morally what benefit would mean, what the benefit of a patient would mean. But if you start analyzing it, then you'll find that basically this term benefit is very ambiguous. It is not clear. Because if you, and please keep in mind, if you take only one of it, then it's fine. But it will conflict with your, it will conflict with the principle of reflective equilibrium. You can't just say that the doctor is to look for physical benefit. But if you take more than one, then you have the problem of conflict between these benefits. What will happen if it's physical benefit, as most of the times it happens, the physical benefit conflicts with the economic benefit. You see, so then you land into trouble. Now you need a higher principle which would decide which is more beneficial and why it is more beneficial. It is not sufficient for us to say that the physical is more beneficial than the economic. You would also have to state why it is so, and for that you would require a higher principle, which becomes another problem. In other words, though this is taken as a duty, the principle underlying it is a utilitarian principle. Because it's saying that is good which benefits the patient. But you have seen that in the utilitarianistic ground, there is a problem of how to quantify this quality. Now, how will you quantify the benefit? So this becomes a real problem. Yes.
We have conclusions based on premises.
Yes.
Now, what are premises based upon? The expectation or what gives rise to the
these premises?
Yeah.
Yes, basically these premises arise because you have already taken into consideration an utilitarian approach to formulate it. So basically you are trying to argue over here what is good, what is morally good for a doctor, right? So what is the theory you adopt? You adopt this theory that is morally good for a doctor which benefits the patient. So that action is good if it benefits the patient. Now the problem over here is unclarity with the term benefit. So that's a problem. Until and unless you have not explicitly defined what benefit means, it becomes a huge problem with this. And you will see what will happen if you take into consideration only physical. Now, this is the second principle. It basically says doctors should do no harm to their patients. Now, intuitively, we all understand this. Intuitively, we all understand this. Now let us analyze this. So argument takes form again in the modus ponens form. And please keep in mind, the argument form is valid. All doctors must not undertake actions which bring harm to their patients. You are a doctor, therefore you must not undertake actions which bring harm to your patients. Now over here also, you will find that the term harm, what does it harm mean? What sort of harm is harm? Is it economical, social, spiritual, emotional? And please keep in mind, if you take a position that you constitute only one of it, then there is no problem. Then your term is explicitly defined. And especially if you say physical also, if you say economic, then it's no problem at all because it is quantifiable. You can convert it into a currency and say rupees, this much is benefited. But if you are also taking physical, how will you even quantify physical benefit? What does physical benefit So you would have to be even explicitly clear with this term what it means. So this again you will find is a utilitarianistic approach. Principle of autonomy. Now this is the third principle. Doctors should abide by the decision of the patients, right? What it basically means is that all doctors should abide by the decision of the patients. You are a doctor, therefore you should abide by the decision of a patient. What basically it means is that you should respect whatever the patient has decided. Now in this case, what does abide by mean? What does it mean by abiding by the patient? Does it mean we have to, you know, abide by unconditionally? Is it unconditional obedience or compliance with the request of the patient? Because if so, okay, then you have no problem of euthanasia and abortion. At least with euthanasia you have no problem. You'll have problem with abortion, because then in abortion you may argue that no, it's the kid's decision who's there inside, not the mother's, because the kid is another life form. But with euthanasia you'll have no such problems, because the patient wants to die, right? So then we have to come to this conclusion that no, autonomy does not mean unqualified obedience, right? So what sort of obedience? When can we override the decision of the patient? Now this slightly shows that the principle of beneficence is over and above the principle of autonomy of the patient. Now, but no such thing was told to you when you were given the principle, because the principles are all your duties. And as we all know, that no duty can be superior than the other. All duties are duties. But here you will see that one duty is superior over the other duty. If you do not accept this, that if you say that no, all duties are at par, then as you can see, the problem of euthanasia will totally disappear. Now the fourth principle of justice, okay, doctors should act in a manner that is just, which we all understand intuitively. The argument form takes this way: all doctors should act in a manner that is just. You are a doctor, therefore you should act in a manner that is just. Again, the same problem comes: how will you decide what is just? So what is just? In terms of benefit? And most of the time, yes. Now, if it is based on the terms of benefit, again, the term benefit must be clarified, which brings us back to principle number one. Again, it appears that it's a utilitarianistic approach, and you have the problem of quantifying a quality. Now, this is the problem, even if you single out one as benefit. Supposing you say only physical is the benefit. Then the problem is, how will you quantify this quality? How will you quantify a quality? Your ECG readings? Is that how you quantify? Will you agree with the quantification of a quality on the basis of your ECG readings and the readings of your heartbeat? No, because it is intuitively not what you are looking for. You will see that something is missing there. Is this what you mean by benefit? That is heart rate, you know, the beating of the heart at this rate, blood pressure at this rate. Is that what we mean by benefit? So how will you quantify your quality? And this problem, please keep in mind, is a problem of all sciences. It's not a problem only faced by medical ethics. It's a problem of all the sciences. Physics faced this problem. But in physics, you quantify all qualities. And that's why it's so accurate. You can quantify all qualities. In fact, there's this saying that physics is nothing but quality quantified. So when you quantify all the qualities in the universe, you can have an absolute physics of all the universe. As long as you fail to quantify a quality, you cannot have physics. So therefore, when a poet will be seeing the color red, a person who is doing physics will be seeing 10 mu. You'll be seeing the wavelength. Now, are you ready to reduce an individual, a human being, to this level, to the level of 10 mu? And by that, you constitute benefit. Now, is that acceptable intuitively? Now, we have to understand that it is not quantifiable in this sense, because it is a much more complex level than what physics is dealing with. The level of complexity that you all are dealing with is so high that it's not basically possible, at least till this moment, theoretically, to have a quality which can be quantified in terms of benefit. In terms of benefit. Because by the term benefit, we do not mean a quantifiable quality. At least intuitively, that is what, you know, when we say that I have benefited him, I don't mean to say that I brought his heartbeat down to this and that. You mean to say that you have given him back a good health. Now, is this good quantifiable in purely physical terms? And if not, then we will have to be really explicit about what it constitutes in. Why do you want to quantify it? Let the patient decide whether he is benefited or not. Right? No, yes. Now, if you let the patient decide, what will happen if you think the patient is benefited, but the patient thinks the patient is not benefited? In other words, this is basically why we do not want a subjective value. If you say that the patient will decide, then the term benefit will become purely subjective. So there is no question of deciding and arguing and debating. The patient says the patient is not benefited, end of the story. That means you have not fulfilled your duty. Are you ready to do that? No, I am not asking you in an empirical sense. Even theoretically, it does not comply with the principle of reflective equilibrium. Because you can't have a subjective feeling as far as benefit is concerned. So you have to have certain parameters. And you all know by now that since this is a utilitarianistic principle, as you all said, it is very difficult to quantify the benefit. Because it's like quantifying happiness, quantifying satisfaction. How will you quantify this satisfaction? So this is basically the problem that we have to face. Usually we operate only with the principles. The four principles, we operate with them. But intuitively we think we even understand what it means. But when you start analyzing it, and you will, why I'm doing this is not to show you that, see, this is very confusing. Why I'm basically doing this is with the purpose that you have to understand that problems in medical ethics arise only because of this. All your problems in medical ethics, okay, can be reduced to one of these problems. Now here you are seeing that there is a problem with the term just itself. Because even if I ask only in this room, confined to this small gathering, you will not agree upon one single definition of just.
I have a question to the group, or to myself, rather. When we talk about this benefit, if the patient has to measure it, if we are treating an unconscious patient, comatose patient, who will decide it? The friends, the parents, or the doctors?
Exactly. That just enforces my point. What I'm basically trying to say is this, that there are different levels of complexities, and we tend to think that there are no such complexities involved. But there are. Even when you make a simple research project and say that the conclusion shows that the villagers will be benefited, are you saying they will be physically benefited? Or the benefit here has a much more wider connotation. Now somebody might come and argue, no, they won't be benefited because these are the problems. Now see, the term benefit over here, okay, is that which produces this confusion. Now, if there is an explicit definition of what benefit would mean, then all these problems would disappear. In fact, there would be no problems. They would dissolve. These problems would simply dissolve. Now, for example, let me put forth another question, which I think is very important for all of us to think. What is the telos, or basically the essence of a doctor? What is a doctor supposed to do? Now, treat patients means what? Reduce him of his suffering or prolong his life? What will happen if both of them conflict in the case of euthanasia? You want to reduce the suffering, but to reduce the suffering, you have to negate that you don't want to take the patient closer to death. Now, if you say, supposing that the duty of a doctor is to preserve life, then euthanasia is in direct conflict with your profession.
Entire realm is complex. And there is less clarity than desirable. What we look for from you is a decision-making process. If we can employ certain principles and philosophy and try to make better decisions than what we are at this point of
exactly.
time.
Exactly. So what basically you would all have to decide now, which I can't decide for you, okay, oh. is the idea whether you would love to be utilitarians in the sense in which we all are. As you all can see, these principles are ultimately based on the utilitarianistic principle. And if so, how do we account for these unclear terms? These terms which are unclear, how do we account for them? So we now have to make it more explicitly clear and such that the community accepts it. It has to be community, the acceptance of the community is very important in these cases. You can't come up with a definition of benefit which only you will agree with. Right? This is why I'm telling you that it is not as simple as is the case in physics.
So can I make a suggestion
yes.
here? I mean, this is one of my thoughts I believe might work out in decision making,
right.
to simplify it, that even if one term has ambiguity in its meaning
right.
among common professionals,
right.
we might still be able to find out some optional meanings out of it. The way we just did, benefit could mean physical, emotional, social,
right.
things like that. So there are some optional implications that we can derive out of the same term.
Right.
Now, can we have some hierarchical priority within the shades of meanings and then say that if the first hierarchy is satisfied, okay, we follow that. If the first one is not possible, maybe the next which comes in priority list could be followed. This way, we can probably trickle down.
You can
helping in decision making.
Exactly. You can do that, provided you have a principle on which you will base the hierarchy.
I feel that it has to be a decision not solely confined according to the patient or according to the doctor. The doctor and the patient on cases, or if the patients are unconscious, then the relatives who all are taking care. It has to be a two-way process. And with that, we can solve most maybe of the conflicts. And because we live in a society, so you can't have your own individual decision. Of course, most of the times there's a medical negligence or anything of this sort. There's a lack of communication is the most important thing that comes out as far as I
right.
understand. So maybe it's not just a one-way process.
Right. No, it's not. That's what is meant by saying that everybody must abide by this rule. It's not only meant for the doctors, meaning it's not that only the doctors have to be moral, even the patient has to be moral, right? So the process is, of course, definitely both ways. But the issue is exactly this, as Sir rightly pointed out, how do we solve these issues? And I would like to recall what we said in the beginning of the session, of the sixth session, that we are not here to provide you solutions of how to solve issues, because let me be very explicit, there are none. There are none which theoretically satisfy all the conditions that we have all nodded our heads and said, yes, they must be satisfied. There is no theory which satisfied all of these conditions. So, in other words, we have to, instead of being theoretically oriented, okay, we have to be oriented into a functional domain. That is what we are all trying to, that's coming out. In other words, that we have to see how we can function in a society morally. With a theory with all its limitations. The theory may have all the limitations, but despite this limitation, how do we make it functional in a society? Right? And this functionality within a society, according to what we discussed just, cannot operate if you are basically unclear with the terms that we all deal with. If benefit means something to you and benefit means something to me, we are not talking about the same thing at all. So most of the conflicts, if you see, you will find that is based on this, that you are not talking about the same thing most of the time. That we are not talking about the same, though we are talking about benefits, the patient is also talking about benefit, the doctor is also talking about the benefit. But what is only common is the utterance benefit. They mean something else. So in a functional stance taken towards ethics, we would have to operate with a minimum degree of clarity with the terms we intend to take. Now, why is the principle of analogy so important? As I told you before, that it makes things very subjective. If the principle of analogy is not operative, then it basically again gets confined to your opinion of what is right in that particular situation, so on and so forth. But we have now engaged in discussions. The example that I was thinking about is what is given by Martin Cohen in his favorite book. It's called Designer Babies. Now this, as you all know, is a huge moral issue, right? Apart from this argument, which I want to leave aside, the argument of playing God, that the first line of attack is this, that who are you to play God? We will keep that line of argument aside. Besides that, why is this thing immoral?
What will happen is that we will be seeing cases in which there are certain specially challenged children, and when we have designer babies, there won't be any room for that. Everything will be perfect utopia, and where will we finally learn to appreciate the other things of the world?
Right, but as I told you, if you keep this aside,
plenty of objections here. One is, what happens to an atheist? And why call a child a gift of God? Those who don't have child, are they deprived of the gift? B. Yes. And I think it's from the current societal norms, we tend to judge that designing a baby is not right. Okay. As we evolve, society is not static, stuck with one perception. As it evolves, I think we will become sufficiently mature to accept this, or immature, whatever, to accept this. So I see nothing wrong in that.
So basically, why are we yes.
I would like to put it this way. I want a child with green eyes.
Yes.
Once he is born, he is thinking that it is bad. So if I am deciding previously, I am breaching his autonomy.
Exactly. That's the only argument that is valid. All the other arguments that you have been giving, as I told you, are all definitional if then. In other words, at the most, it will be a conventional if then. That's why I told you, given the fact that we remove this idea, that it's not a problem as far as, you know, God is concerned. God is nowhere in the scene. Apart from that, purely on a theoretical level, where is the problem? And the problem is this. Supposing you decide that the child should have four hands, okay, because then he can type two computers at the same time and will become, you know, or something like that. Or as you said, you want her to look like Aishwarya, so you everything you make like Aishwarya. And this child, after it comes to his senses, says, I didn't like this. Now, how do you act as an, you know, how do you resolve this conflict of autonomy?
Sir, on the other hand, knowingly very well that there are certain genetic diseases and there are methods to find out before the birth takes place.
Yes.
And if we don't do it and the child is born, suppose some deadly disease like thalassemia, child will tell us, the parents, why did you not do the genetic test and don't make me born at all?
Yes. You see, so this is the point. Who will decide now what is disadvantages and what is advantages? Having blue eyes is disadvantages. Now, who will decide? You or the child? In other words, you here what basically we are trying to say is this, that here you have to resolve it by drawing a line between what you think is benefit and what is objectively beneficial, right? And this has to be done explicitly. You can't just assume it. And the demarcating line should apply to the principle of analogy, you know, should conform to the principle of analogy. That is, on all such cases, this is a disadvantage and this is an advantage. Now here, most of the time we argue because basically we have not explicitly drawn the line of what is beneficial and what is not beneficial. Having a blue eye, is it beneficial? Not having a gene which may result, you know, in the child being diabetic is beneficial. Is having blue eyes beneficial? This example that I gave you is formulated by Martin Cohen, but it is not Martin Cohen's own example. It occurs in 350 BC in Plato's Republic, where Plato goes to his friend and finds that the friend is breeding different breeds of dogs to get a good hunting dog. Now this, in other ways, is a designer dog. So Plato raises this question to this friend that, is it moral for you to do this? And the friend says, of course. Why? Because it serves your purpose. In other words, that dog is purely a means for you. That is basically means you are not treating the dog as an autonomous human being. That's basically what he meant to say. That if you are saying, no, that this is, then you would think, beneficial for whom this whole question arises, which you'll have to address in the case of designer babies. So let me take you to some other example, which I just want to highlight so that it comes, the principle of analogy becomes clear. Now you see, harvesting tissues and cells. Now here also I'm telling you, leave aside the part of God, okay? You don't, let us not argue that why you are playing God. Because if you bring God into the picture, it's very problematic, okay? So we will leave God out. Let God be there as an observer. And apart from that, how does this raise a moral issue? Why should we not harvest stem cells? Or, harvest cells and tissues? Why not? We should. What is the, then why are these people unhappy about?
Even if you put 100,000 laws, when you have the technology and knowledge, you are going to go ahead there. And some people might use it wrong, but most will mature into beings who would be using it for right.
Yes, but see, the problem with this kind of thing, in theory, why they are not being upheld unanimously is because in theory, it is a huge problem in relation to two of the things. One, it does not conform to the principle of analogy. And two, when it does not conform, there is a problem of reflective equilibrium. See, now you are saying, therefore, that it is okay to harvest cells and tissues as long as it is beneficial for another individual. So if it is benefiting another individual, it's fine to do this. Now take this example, a theoretical, this is a thought experiment, right? So take this thought experiment where a mother wants to have a child, okay, but not as a child. She wants the child, okay, to feed some other child, another child of hers, with cells and tissues which only this new born can provide. In this thought experiment, would you still consider that this is moral? Will you consider this as moral? No, supposing, make the thought experiment more strong. The child doesn't live. It is just reared to feed tissues and cells to this new, to the old offspring. Will that be moral? But by principle of analogy, it should be moral. Because it is moral to harvest cells and tissues, right? As long as it benefits some other individual. A purely utilitarianistic principle. Principle of analogy extended to this thought experiment, and you will see that there is a lot of problem. Right? So in other words, again, coming back to the same thing, explicit clarity in terms of the terms that are being used. We treat the terms as if intuitively we know whatever is stated is clear. We should not do harm. Intuitively we understand what harm means. If everything is so intuitive and so clear, these problems, at least majority of them, will simply dissolve. Will simply dissolve. In other words, the if-then that the basic arguments of medical ethics are based on is conventional or definitional.
When we talk of animals or say plants.
So
there the physical benefit and all doesn't come to play.
There it's a here, different level of complexity.
It's a different thing. So here I think for it is because we are talking of human beings, that is why we are talking of the physical thing.
Yes.
Actually, when ethics comes, it is more of emotional, social, spiritual and all those things. Because if otherwise if we take plants, then there we don't, like, if we want to experiment with plants, research ethics may be involved, work ethics may be involved, but other ethics like a consent or something like that, there's no question.
Yes, no, see, that is what you feel. Now let me tell you that there are groups who feel no, you should take the informed consent. Now take for example this huge upheaval in Mumbai, where stones were painted with advertisement on the expressway, stones were painted, okay, with various advertisement. And there was an activist group who said you don't have the right to paint the stone because the stones have rights. No, see, here it may sound very funny, but in the US this is a very serious issue.
So I think it's perception.
Can you divert a river? Now we would. Why not? See, in other words, it simply means whether you treat anything apart from human beings as ends in themselves, or do you only construe them as means? If you construe them as means, then there is no problem. But if you construe them as end in themselves, then there is a lot of problem. And as I always say, in philosophy, no discussion is short.